Genesis 42, go there with me. We've all heard the phrase, I'm sure. It's darkest before the, say it again. It's darkest before the dawn. It's attributed to a man named Thomas Fuller, a 17th century English historian who penned it in one of his works. I'm not going to try to pronounce it. But the gist is of the phrase is sort of like this, right? Challenging times tend to precede new beginnings or positive changes. Probably experienced that. Or even in the moments of greatest despair, hope is on the horizon. Katie and I recently watched a movie called The Long Game. The Long Game. Anybody seen that? The Long Game? Okay, a few of you? Okay. Mickey, he was bawling while he's watching, I'm sure. The Long Game is about a group of high school athlete golfers. They're Hispanic, and they are the first Hispanic golf team to win state in the state of Texas. And so I think it was set in the 50s. It's a true story. And during that time, they suffered extreme prejudice, right? Outright actions that targeted them because they were Mexican, okay? But in the end, right, great effort, much perseverance, they won the state championship. It's darkest before the dawn. Now, in Christian circles, in our Christian worldview, we have a phrase that is kind of like that. It comes from the blueprint of the life of Jesus Christ, and it's simply this: suffering, then, anybody? Come on. Suffering, then, rhymes with shmori. Suffering, then, glory. Suffering, then, glory. That was the way of Christ. Well, we understand this. We live in a Genesis 3 world. Temptation. Some of you felt temptation today, last night, yesterday. Temptation, sin, disappointment, suffering, evil. And don't get me wrong, there's great joy in this Genesis 3 world, right? The birth of a child, getting married, winning. There's all sorts of great joys. But we are headed in this Genesis 3 world to a Revelation 21:22 world. And in that world, there will be the absence of the darkness of evil. Right? All things will be made new, is what Revelation 21 tells us. That world will be full of glory and goodness and grace and freedom and joy and love and God's presence. Sin will not be there. And so for the Christian, there is this real sense, temporally speaking, of suffering, then glory. This sequence of dark to light, despair to hope, suffering to glory begins for the sons of Jacob in Genesis 42. We could call this the sequence guilt to pardon. Now, of course, in Genesis 42, we're not going to see the pardon in its culmination, right? That's going to stretch out over a few chapters. But we're going to see the seeds of it here in 42. And it begins with a reunion, a family reunion. And that family reunion is filled with guilt and it's filled with fear. But it's also through this narrative that we're reminded of God's gloriously purposeful work in us. And it's this: godly guilt. You can say godly grief, godly guilt. It produces repentance. That's how the Lord uses godly guilt. It produces repentance. Again, we're not going to see repentance in chapter 42, but God is setting the stage in the heart of Jacob's sons to get there. Right, repentance would come for them, and it will come for them, as we will see. Reconciliation will come for them, we will see, with Joseph, but not yet. And to get there, it would be a hard work because Joseph's brothers were hardened men. Now, let me just remind you of some of the things that these 10 boys had done in their life. Remember Simeon and Levi in Genesis, I believe, chapter 34? They slaughtered the Shechemite men in revenge, vengeance, for the rape of their sister. Or the firstborn Reuben. Remember Reuben? He took his dad's concubine because he wanted primacy in the home. That's Genesis 35, 22. Or the fourth son, Judah. Remember old, good old Judah? He ended up sleeping with a prostitute who was actually his daughter-in-law and then had twins with her, right? That was Judah. And then Genesis 37, the end of it, of course, you got all 10 brothers, excluding Benjamin. Benjamin wasn't a part of this motley crew, but all 10 brothers deciding they were going to kill Joseph. But then in God's providence, a caravan came by and they sold him into slavery. Again, these men were hardened men. They weren't soft men. They were hardened men. And so to break them, God had to confront them. And it would be through a hard work. They needed to be confronted with their sin. They needed to feel the pangs of conscience. You ever felt that? The pang of conscience? Where you just feel pricked? Have you ever felt that in a sermon where you just feel stitched to the pew? Like God is speaking directly to you and you can't even move because you feel the weight of the Holy Spirit upon you. Have you ever felt that before? That's what they needed. They needed to be broken, not busted. You know what the difference, right? Being busted for sin, that's when you feel bad towards other people. They needed to be broken before God so they can mourn to get to repentance. But the truth is they needed bread. They needed bread. And because they needed bread, they were gonna get salvation. Because they needed bread and God sent famine, they were gonna get repentance. They would feel their sin. They would feel their guilt. They would ultimately repent, experience reconciliation, and be saved. But it all started because they needed bread. Look at verses 1 through 5 in chapter 42, if you would, with me. It says, when Jacob learned that there was grain for sale in Egypt. Remember, 7 years of famine. The world had been hit. When Jacob learned this, he said to his sons, why do you look at one another like we're being lazy? And he said, behold, I have heard that there is grain for sale in Egypt. Go down, buy grain for us there, that we may live and not die. So ten of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain in Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, with his brothers, for he feared that harm might happen to him. Thus the sons of Israel came to buy among the others who came, for famine was in the land of Canaan. So famine had touched God's promised people, and the plan, Jacob's plan, was to send his boys down to Egypt to get grain so that they could survive. But of course, we see again, by the way, Jacob is just the worst scoundrel in Genesis 42. We're not going to get into that. But he's showing preferential treatment again to the son of Rachel, Benjamin. He feared that Benjamin might experience harm, destruction, kind of like Joseph did many years before, so he wouldn't let him go. Now look at verse 6. And if you have a pen or a highlighter, this is the time where you need to mark up your Bible, because this is a beautiful verse. It says, now Joseph was governor over the land. Don't highlight yet. He was the one who sold to all the people of the land. Pause, don't do it yet. Now here's where you do it. And Joseph's brothers came, and say it with me, and bowed themselves before him with their faces to the ground. And so this is God's faithfulness. It had been 20 years. 20 years earlier, Joseph received the dreams. The two dreams that started out this process of great suffering, great conflict, great affliction for Joseph. And now God is fulfilling that promise. Remember, he told him that his brothers would bow down to him. The sheaves would bow down to the sheaf, Joseph's sheaf. And now we see it in, if you highlighted it, in color. If you want to write down there, you could write Genesis 37, 5 through 8 in your Bible. That connects you to the dream so you can know where the promise is made. 20 years later, God fulfills it. Look at verses 7 and 8. Joseph saw his brothers and recognized them, but he treated them like strangers. He spoke roughly to them. Where do you come from? He said. They said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. And Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. And Joseph remembered the dreams that he had dreamed of them. Okay, let's pause. So not only do we make the connection that God is faithful, that he always keeps his promise in verse 6, but so does Joseph at the beginning of verse 9. He realizes, huh, I remember my dreams. I remember God's promise. It has come to fruition. He's having this aha moment. As a Christian, don't you know how glorious it is to see God work in your life? Have you ever stopped for a moment and looked and saw the work of God in your life and just been blown away? I was meeting with a couple just a few weeks ago, and the wife said this, and I just thought it was awesome. She said that she loves to keep a prayer journal because in her prayer journal, she's able to look back and see how God answers her prayers. It helps her remember. And I was encouraged by that because, hey, look, there is a believer in Christ who is pursuing Jesus in this particular way. And it just encouraged me. But also I was instructed in that moment because if you're not running after God, you're not going to see his hand in your life. You're not going to have eyes to see the work of God in your life if you're not pursuing him. You will be blind. When was the last time that you said, God is good? And you really meant that God is good. Like it wasn't just some saying. When was the last time that God answered a prayer of yours and you thanked him for it? If you can't recall a time when God has been working in your life, it's probably because you're not seeing with spiritual eyes. Likely you're walking in the flesh. Right, you're walking in the flesh, you're not living by the Spirit. If you don't hear the voice of the Lord and the chirping of the birds or a beautiful sunrise, if you don't see him in his word and you don't taste him in his word, if you don't experience these things in your life, it might be that though you believe these things to be true, you are practically living like an atheist, like God doesn't exist, though you confess he does. And so Joseph, he was able to remember his dreams because God was always at the forefront of his life. He ran hard after God, and because he did that, God was present to him in his experience. He knew it, he could see it. Now, I told you before, the breaking of the boys, the men at this point, would be hard because they were hardened men. And we begin to see that here in these verses as Joseph deceives his brothers and then begins to test his brothers. Okay, look at verses 9 through 17 with me. It says, and Joseph remembered the dreams that he had dreamed of them. And he said to them, you are spies. You've come to see the nakedness of the land. And they said to him, no, my lord, your servants have come to buy food. We are all sons of one man, and we are honest men. Your servants have never been spies. And Joseph said to them, no, it is the nakedness of the land that you've come to see, which is another way of saying the vulnerabilities of the land, the weaknesses that are here in Egypt. And they said, we your servants are 12 brothers. So we're going to explain. We're not spies. Let me tell you, we your servants are 12 brothers, the sons of one man in the land of Canaan. And behold, the youngest is this day with our father, and one is no more. Right, as they speak to the one who is no more. But Joseph said to them, It is as I said to you, you are spies. By this you shall be tested. By the life of Pharaoh, you shall not go from this place unless your youngest brother comes here. Send one of you, and let him bring your brother while you remain confined, that your words may be tested, whether there is truth in you, or else by the life of Pharaoh, surely you are spies. And he put them all together in custody for 3 days. So Joseph recognizes his brothers. He's living in the land of Egypt. All the men are shaved, 10 Hebrew men with beards. Not too difficult for Joseph, but his brothers don't recognize him because he looks like an Egyptian. They also don't recognize him because, well, he had an interpreter between them. Look in your Bible, look at verse 23. So in verse 23, it says, they did not know Joseph understood them, for there was an interpreter between them. So he was speaking to them with a different language. But then thirdly, they didn't know it was Joseph. They were deceived by Joseph because They thought Joseph was no more. At best, Joseph was sold into slavery. He was not second in command of all of Egypt. He was not vizier of the land. And so they don't recognize him, though Joseph does. And Joseph, brushing off their explanation, says, "You guys are spies." Now that would hold water because there's 10 guys looking for food for one home. Like, really, 10 brothers from one home? Yeah, so he gives this charge against them, and so that causes them to share the goods. "Oh, we'll tell you the truth. Right, there's actually 12 of us. One, the youngest, is at home with Dad, Benjamin, and another one, well, he's gone. He's no more. And then there's us 10. And so he tells them all this stuff, but he brushes it off and throws them into prison. Now, with this, he's testing them like he was tested. Right? Think about it. They oppressed him, now he oppresses them. 20 years earlier, they had thrown Joseph into the pit, and now he throws them into prison. They had accused him of being a lying dreamer, and now he accuses them of being lying spies. He is testing them and afflicting them like he was afflicted. Look at verses 18 through 23. God's going to use this affliction to break them. It says, "On the third day, Joseph said to them," so 3 days have passed, they're in prison. He says, "Do this and you will live, for I fear God. If you're honest men, let one of your brothers remain confined." Now remember, 9 were going to be, but now he switches it, just one. "Let one of your brothers remain confined where you are in custody. Let the rest go and carry grain for the famine of your households. And bring your youngest brother to me, so your words will be verified and you shall not die." And they did so. Now that's out of chronological order. They did so in a few minutes, right? That doesn't happen quite yet, but it's just reporting that this is what happens. Then they said to one another, after getting this news, they said to one another, verse 21, "In truth, we are guilty concerning our brother, and that we saw the distress of his soul." Now they're remembering 20 years earlier. "We saw the distress of his soul. And when he begged us, we did not listen. That is why this distress has come upon us." And Reuben answered them, "Did I not tell you not to sin against the boy? But you did not listen. So now there comes a reckoning for his blood." They did not know that Joseph understood them, for there was an interpreter between them. In these verses, we see our first point. It's this. If you have a bulletin, you can see it there. As Christians, we must see our sin against God. Really, people, you must see your sin against God. 3 days they sat in prison. It's a long time to think about the wrong things that they had done, to discuss their unfortunate situation. And when Joseph comes to them, what happens? He changes the plan. Rather than leaving 9 and sending 1, he leaves 1 and sends 9. Why would Joseph do this? Because he loves his family. 9 men bringing back food for the home. He loves his family. He sends plenty of grain for their family. But what's incredible is, as he's telling them the plan, he invokes the name of God. Look at verse 18 in your Bible. He says, "Do this and you will live, for I fear God." Now these are the sons of Jacob, the people of promise. The one whose great-grandfather was Abraham. God showed up to him in Ur of the Chaldeans and called him out of idolatry and into his great promises. And they are hearing what they think is an Egyptian call on the name of God. And that convicts them to their very core. When they hear that, they are burdened with guilt. They talk. And they realize that they had treated, we know that because we hear them in the text, they had treated their brother so poorly 20 years earlier. Joseph had begged them, and we didn't see that in the narrative, but he had begged them to set him free, begged for mercy, but no mercy came. And in their mind, it was time to pay the piper. Judgment had come. It was the day of reckoning. The brothers see their sin against God. It weighed heavy on them in the prison. And like them, we must see our sin against God. I think as Christians, we often like to turn away from our sin. Not in the good way, but in the I don't want to see it way. Ignore, that's the better word than turn away. We like to ignore it. I think often sometimes we plug our ears to the truth that we are sinners. Have you ever been rebuked by someone? If you haven't, you need it. All right, it stinks, but it's good. Right? We plug our ears toward it or we cover our eyes. But we need to see our sin because seeing our sin is like a spiritual MRI of our soul. It helps us understand who we are. It helps us understand the truth about us, not some fictional fairy tale. Right? It gets to the core of our greatest need, which is forgiveness and a Savior. And so we need to see our sin. The question is how? How do we cultivate a practice in our life of seeing our sin? I'm glad you asked. That's a great answer. That's a great question, Peter. Good. You got to read what? You looked so, you're like thoughtful over there. So you got to read your Bible. Here's a simple one. How do I cultivate it? You got to read your Bible prayerfully. Prayerfully. One of the habits I do when I get ready to read God's word is I pray to the Lord before I read. I ask him to incline my ear to his testimonies. I ask him to open my eyes to see wonderful things from his word. I ask him to unite my heart, meaning give me a oneness to believe your promises. I want my heart to believe this is true. I don't want to be divided as the James 1 man is divided. I want to be all together to believe your promises. And then above my bed, I have Psalm 90:14. And above my bed, it says, satisfy me in the morning with your unfailing love. When I get ready to read the word, I say that prayer. I mean, I've said that prayer probably for 5 to 8 years regularly, not every time, but regularly, because I need to posture my heart to hear from God. I need the posture of my heart to be receptive to the Lord because I need strengthening and I need help and I need convicting. And when we look at the Bible, we should pray before we read, but we should pray as we read. Like you should read this and go, wow, I'm not doing that in my parenting. Oh my goodness, I've been acting like that sin is no big deal. Father, break me. Forgive me. Help me as I repent. Change this in my children. Strengthen this in my marriage. Help the deacons see that this is true and let them live after it. Help my life group leaders see the significance, Father, of teaching your word week in and week out. Would you strengthen my preaching as I see this so the people could see it? Look at your Bible prayerfully. Like if you want to cultivate a heart that sees your sin, don't plug your ears, don't shield your eyes. We don't ignore it, but we see it. We got to be in the word prayerfully. Secondly, you got to do this. You got to be a member of a local church. Now, for most of you, I'm preaching to the choir, right? All of you are here at church, but you need to be a member of a local church. Why? Because this is an accountable fellowship. An accountable fellowship. That means you hear God's word taught in corporate worship, right? That means you go to life group and you listen to God's word. That means you have discipleship groups where you talk about God's word and you pray for one another. You're an accountable fellowship. And when you hear God's word, you're encouraged. I hear stories all the time of how the teaching and preaching of this church encourages your heart, but I also hear stories of how the Holy Spirit convicts you. He steps on your toes and says, you aren't where I want you to be. Repent and believe again. It's good. It's what we need. I need it. You need it. But then beyond that, we have a web of relationships that encourage us, that strengthen us, that helps us become more effective in ministry, more in love with the Lord. Isn't this cool? Think about this. You guys are listening to a pastor preach from Genesis 42, which was written thousands of years ago. And you are believing that. And the person next to you is believing that. In that simple act of the Holy Spirit working in your heart, is that not encouraging? Like look to your left and right real quick. If you can turn your neck, right? Look to the left and right. Glenn Miller, left and right. I told you I was gonna keep you up this morning. Right, look at, and here's the deal. Isn't that encouraging that they are believing like you are believing? That they truly see that this is God's word and God is working. And so you need to be a part of an accountable fellowship. That's what you need. We already have many families signed up for our meaningful membership seminar this coming Sunday next week. But I'd love for you to be signed up. Like, come talk to me. Like, you need more than just attendance. You need an accountable fellowship where you can walk through life together with people, a web of relationships, keeping you, helping you, and guiding you. Okay, those are two things. There are so many more things that I could pinpoint on, but those are two things. If you do these two things, in the Lord, that's the significant part, in the Lord, you will blaze a path where you will see your sin. You'll see it, but it's not enough to see it. And that's where my second point comes in. It's not enough to see your sin. You gotta feel the guilt of your sin against God. We have to feel the weight of our sin against God. That's what we see in the brothers. They recognize their sin, and then they feel properly about their sin. They realize the heinous actions they had done. And you know what? They knew God was after them. Like, they were like, oh, uh-oh, God's coming. It's the day of reckoning. It's the time for blood. God's coming. You know, if you acknowledge your sin without lamenting sin against God, it's kind of like having gas, fuel, like having fuel, in that it's ineffective unless it's put into a tank. Until it goes into the tank, fuel is ineffective. It doesn't do anything. It's like a smelly, like gasoline smelly paperweight. But as soon as you put it into the tank and then the engine strikes it, then it is proper and it's worth something. And that's how seeing our sin is. Until we feel and lament against God or for God because of our sin, we don't properly understand it. It's like when your kid says, I know what I did, but I don't care. Teachers, have you ever heard that? I know what I did. I don't care. It's like, we don't want to be that way towards God. I know what I did, God, but I don't care. Well, they weren't. And so when it comes to feeling guilt before God, we don't want to be deadened. We also don't want to be depressed. And so cultivating proper feelings is a work of the Spirit in us. It's through the Word of God, the Spirit works in us. He sanctifies us so that over time, well, we would feel more properly as we ought to. Probably the best strategy in the Bible to be sensitive to sin, to be sensitive to sin is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 20. This is probably, in my opinion, the greatest strategy to be sensitive to sin over time. Paul says this, he says, brothers, do not be children. Do I have that? Yeah, there it is. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. Babies are sweet and precious. They're awesome. Many of you have babies. Some of you got some toddlers. But they don't know a thing, right? Like, you know, they know, like, tiny. Their world is so small. They have no sense of what's happening around them. If you got an infant in this room right now, anybody got an infant you're holding? Anybody? We got one back there. Okay. No idea that I'm preaching. Not an idea, like, probably sleeping. No idea. That's how our relationship to evil should be. We should be babies in evil. That's what Paul says. And so take your mind. What are you putting in your mind? What are you reading? What are you listening to? What comments are you following on Instagram or Facebook? Are those things cultivating experience in evil? Are they cultivating experience, knowledge, intimacy with evil? Paul would say what is good and noble and blameless and proper. Set your mind on those things, what is true. Or take your eyes. If you want to be babies in evil, take your eyes. What are you watching? What reels draw you on social media? What YouTube pages do you pant for, like a thirsty deer pants for water? Who has your eye? Where is your gaze transfixed? Jesus said that the eye is the lamp of the body. If your eye is sick or dark, your body and your soul is sick and dark. It's a paraphrase, of course. And so we turn our eyes upon Jesus. We look to him. What about your hands? Have you given ground in your life to sin? Just kind of thrown up the white flag. Just going to let sin abound in my life. What about alcohol? Is it controlling you? Mastering you? What about sexual immorality? You living with your girlfriend or boyfriend? Playing house? What about your phone? What are you looking at? Oh, Josh, that's... What about your tongue? You gossiping? Are you crude? No. You have a great presentation. Everything looks perfect on the outside. Are you a hypocrite? Like the Pharisees of old. One way here, but in the heart, oof, dead man's bones. Are you proud? If you want to feel the proper weight and guilt for sin in your life, you have got to grow into a baby when it comes to evil. You've got to be immature in evil. You don't want to be experienced in evil. Be like Paul, be experienced and thoughtful with your mind and your eyes and your hands, but innocent babies with evil. The question is, why would you want to feel this? Like, Josh, you're making this sound really bad. Why do I want to see and feel my guilt before God? I'm glad you asked. Let's finish our passage and I'll show you why. I think we're picking up in verse 26. Is that where we're at? 24 through 26, it says this. Then he turned away from them and wept and returned to them. So he wept because they don't know who he is, right? But he's seeing them and he's like, oh, I hate that I'm afflicting them. But he's also seeing them broken and it's moving him. They feel so sorry for what they had done to him. He turned away and wept, and he returned to them and spoke to them. And he took Simeon from them and bound him before his eyes. He's going to keep pressing this test and afflicting his brothers. He binds him before their eyes. Verse 25, and Joseph gave orders to fill the bags with grain and to replace every man's money in his sack and to give them provisions for the journey. This was done for them. They leave. And they loaded their donkeys and their grain and they departed. Verse 27, and as one of them opened his sack, so now they've left, they opened his sack to give his donkey some fodder at the lodging place. He saw his money in his sack. Again, Joseph has replaced the money because he's not going to let his family go broke because of the famine. Like, he's going to take care of the people of promise. He's going to provide for them. They will not be poor. So he does this out of love. He provides for them. 28 and following. He said to my brothers, my money has been put back. Here it is in the mouth of my sack. At this, their hearts failed them. This is another verse to highlight. And they turned trembling to one another saying, what is this that God has done to us? When they came to Jacob, their father, in the land of Canaan, they told him all that happened to them. Not really all, right? They leave out some, oh, we were in jail. They leave out some stuff. They said, the man, the Lord of the land, hey, Dad, listen, the man, the Lord of the land spoke roughly to us, took us to be spies of the land. But we said to him, we are honest men. We have never been spies. We're 12 brothers, sons of our father. One is no more, and the youngest is this day with our father in the land of Canaan. Dad, then the man, the Lord of the land, he said to us, by this I shall know that you are honest men. Leave one of your brothers with me and take grain for the famine of your household and go your way. Bring your youngest brother to me. Then I shall know that you are not spies but honest men, and I will deliver your brother to you and you shall trade in the land. As they emptied their sacks, right? They're showing their purses, their food bags to Dad. Behold, every man's bundle of money was in his sack. And when they and their father saw their bundles of money, they were afraid. What is happening? What is God doing? What's going to happen to the people of promise? What's going to happen to my family? What will Jacob do? Well, he'll do what Jacob normally does. Look at verse 36 and following. And Jacob, their father, right? This is the chief patriarch alive. Their father said to them, "You have bereaved me of my children." Basically, why did you tell him this information? Joseph is no more, and Simeon is no more, right? He's bound in Egypt. And now you would take Benjamin? All this has come against me. He's just so selfish. Verse 37. Then Reuben, right, firstborn, said to father, "Kill my two sons if I do not bring him back to you. Put him in my hands and I will bring him back to you." Right, if you're that careless with your own boys, why would you put your prized son in his possession? Verse 38. But Jacob said, "My son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead and he is the only one left. If harm should happen to him on the journey that you are to make, you would bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to Sheol," which is the place of the dead. Right? Jacob is entirely self-focused, and the narrative ends like this. I mean, think about this. The sons have come back. They've been given instruction. Their only salvation for Simeon is if Benjamin comes home. Jacob hears the news, and he says, "No, it's not going to happen. And I'm definitely not putting my son Benjamin in your hands, Reuben." And that's where the narrative concludes in verse 42. But as we conclude, we ask this question: why in the world would we want to see our sin and feel our guilt against God? Well, I think it's because we look and see what is doing in the lives of the 10 brothers. Look back at verse 28. What is it doing? At this, their hearts failed them. Now they saw the money, their hearts are failed, they turn trembling. Right, they're so afraid that they're actually, there's a tremor. And they say to one another, "What is this that God has done to us?" What is this? They feel the guilt. They see what's happening. They see God at work. And they're terrified. The guilt for sin causes them to fear God, to fear the Lord, fear his judgment. Fear for paying for the evil that they engineered against their brother 20 years earlier. Again, it's not matured yet. Right? It's not in full bloom yet. We will see that as we continue in the narrative. But it is maturing toward repentance. The fear of God is maturing where it should be going. It's moving for the brothers toward life. Why do we want to see our sin against God and feel guilt against God for it? Because we want life. We want to be marked by fear of the Lord. I want you to imagine, we'll close with this. Imagine taking a toddler over to your neighbors. Maybe you got like a little three-year-old. Take your toddler to your neighbors and you knock on the door and the neighbor shows up, right, at the door, and you know, you got the glass. And next to the neighbor is this massive dog, like massive, huge, bulging muscles, like terrifying looking dog. It is strong. It is taller than your three-year-old toddler. And as you get ready to open the door, your toddler makes eye contact with the dog, kind of looks up. What does your toddler do? Runs, right? Like, I'm getting out of here. Your toddler turns and runs away. And as your toddler is running, the neighbor says, "Hey, don't run. He doesn't like that." And as he says that, there's this low guttural growl coming from the dog. He chases those who run. So he calls your kid back to the door and he says, "But, you know, you can come up and pet him. You can listen to the strength of his breathing. You can feel his muscles. In fact, if you would just place your hand on him, you can walk with him. And that growl you heard won't be to consume you. to bite you and to tear you apart. It'll actually be a growl of protection. This is why we want to experience godly guilt, because it moves us to the cross. Right? It moves us not away, but to God, where the love and mercy of God mingles with the justice of God, where Christ takes our pardon. It's poured out on Jesus. The cross is the reason and the path for you to not be destroyed by the presence of God in your life. Do you realize that? You can be in God's presence without fear of destruction, and you can tremble at his greatness. You can feel the strength of his mighty power and wrath for sin without being consumed because of the cross. And so our sin, don't allow sin in your life like the toddler to take you away from God. I mean, sin does, but don't run away in sin. Don't run away in sin. See your sin. Feel the weight of your sin and turn back. Let it move you to Jesus, the one who bears your sin, the one who forgives the repentant. In fact, I would say this: place the hand of faith on the heart and chest of the Savior, and you will be covered by his strength and his forgiveness and his pardon. So why do you want to see your sin and feel the weight of your sin? Because you want Jesus. Like, that's a Sunday school answer, isn't it? You want Jesus. You can find forgiveness, and you can find protection, and you can find grace in the Lord. But it's only when you see your sin for what it is and feel properly before God and you turn in repentance. Anyone can do it. If you see it, feel it, and turn. Would you go to God, go to Christ, and find forgiveness? Father, we come to you this morning, and we thank you for Genesis chapter 42, a story of severe testing of the 10 brothers, a story of grace, a story of guilt, a story of fear, a story of sin, and reminds us of the importance of recognizing who we are and in faith and in repentance turning to you. So God, would you do that in us? As Christians, we need to do that every day. See our sin and turn. But for some in here, it might be today that they need to do it for the first time, to trust in your son Jesus and find forgiveness and find a life. So God, we pray that you would work that in them. We love you, and as we respond to you, by your Spirit, move in us, we pray. In Christ's name, amen.